Welcome to our webinar on taking marketing automation to the next level. I'm your host, Fabian, and with me, I've brought my colleague, Quintijn van Kessel from Forberg. And let me share our presentation with you real quick. Okay, so what we're talking through today will be a case where we used marketing automation through Google Cloud for our client Transavia to help them reach another level with digital marketing. We're going to start off with a short introduction, keep it as short as possible. These are the two people who will, okay, the one image disappeared, interesting. The two people who will present everything to you, that's me and Quintijn. Just a quick reminder of who we are. So what we're doing is we're building our foundation on three pillars: on technology and creatives and media management, which we are connecting through data and insights, which is particularly important today. And we deliver that all for brands, agencies, and publishers. We are also a collective of specialists certified for all different pieces of Google tech. And we're devoted to delivering and optimizing audience-centric, data-driven marketing infrastructures. And particularly important today is that we are a Google Cloud partner, because that's also what we used, the knowledge we used to help Transavia. And now I'm handing over to Quintijn with the main topic of today. Okay. One thing to note, you can always ask questions through the chat. We will answer those questions after the presentation.
Okay, guys. Today we want to talk to you about a case that we did for our client Transavia. It's a case in which I'm particularly proud, because it's really, I think it's quite advanced, and it's really taking the advantage of everything that is currently available in the industry without grabbing to tools that are over expensive and you name it. But before we go into the case itself, I want to briefly talk you through multi-moment marketing. I'm not sure if everybody in this webinar has heard of this. This is a study done by Boston Consultancy Group, and they actually say that they categorize companies into four different pillars: nascent, emerging, connected, and multi-moment. Which obviously multi-moment is where you want to be, because that means that you're connecting and that you're communicating with your end client on such a way that it really fits their needs and their current needs, more specific. Really making sure that every data signal that you get in is used to communicate correct towards your end clients. Unfortunately, only 2% of companies are actually there, according to this study. Almost 90% is somewhere between emerging and connected. And that's not that weird. The 2% that's really currently in multi-moment are the really, the companies that are quite far ahead, that are really innovative. You can think about Netflix, Spotify, those kind of companies that are taking marketing to a next level. Those can be categorized in multi-moment marketing companies. But a lot of companies are not there yet. But what do you need to get there? Because it should be an end goal of every company that's doing marketing on a larger scale. And obviously you need a very solid technical foundation. You need connected data, you need integrated technology, and you need actionable measurement. But that's on the inside. You also need people that actually can work with it. Can be your own people, employees within the company, can be partners, can be a combination of that, but it doesn't just get done with getting technology in. you also need to actually embed that technology in everyday uses in your marketing. And you have to have a culture in which you can do a lot of testing, in which it's okay to fail as long as you learn from it and then go back up again and do another test and so on and so on. So these are really essential points to have in your company if you want to do multi-moment marketing. Just one of those or just a partial set of those won't do the trick. Obviously, it's also very important to look into why you would want to do that. And the study of Boston Consulting Group also showed that companies that went from nascent to multi-moment increased their revenue significantly by being more effective and reduced costs significantly on the other side by being more efficient. Combining that, it's not just very good to have multi-moment marketing for your marketing efforts alone, but it also makes sense business-wise. So before we dive into the case, also a little bit about Transavia. I think most of you might already know Transavia, but for the ones that don't, or maybe a little bit of additional information, Transavia is part of a bigger group, the Air France KLM group, and it's the smaller sister. And the smaller sister has its advantages and its disadvantages, because obviously budgets are smaller. But on the other hand, when you're the smaller sister, you can also be a little bit more innovative. You can test easier. You can do more data-driven things, for instance. They have 88 destinations, all short-haul within Europe. Mid-price carrier, which means that that's actually a big, big challenge, because you're not the cheapest and you're also not the best. You're somewhere in between. So you have to be smart about what you do. And the good thing is that they are a full-stack client with us since 2013, meaning that they use everything that Google Marketing Platform has to offer, and even outside of Google Marketing Platform, which you will see later on in this presentation. So their challenge is to fill up these seats, but there's an additional challenge, because not just any seat, right? They want to sell the seats or try to sell the seats via marketing, which don't sell by themselves and which are very lucrative to sell. You have to imagine that margins are really small in this industry and that loyalty is no longer an existing thing within the current the current world. And there's also a lot of competition going on. So that being said about Transavia, let's dive into the case study. Transavia had a challenge for us, saying like, okay, we have two main issues. First of all, we have a one-stop, one-size-fits-all communication style, and that's not how we want to be, right? So, for instance, if you went to their website and you looked for a flight from Amsterdam to Barcelona, you're getting a banner saying, Amsterdam, Barcelona, buy a ticket now from 39 euros. No matter what you did on their website, it was always the same message. It was plain retargeting without any additional intelligence behind it. And another big point was that they were using communication prices, the from 39 euros. That's because their prices are yielding, right? So actually all airlines do this, and also hotels, for instance, do this based on their load factor, on how full the flights are and how far away the flight is from the current date, they give it the load factor. And based on that load factor, they make a pricing. But that pricing is not the same as the communication pricing. So that means that if you see a banner from 39 euros and you click on it, you go to the website, you see 150 euros. And that's quite a disappointment. That's something that they wanted to get away from. But that's not easy if you have yielding prices.
So I'm sorry to jump in. I think we have a bit of delay with the slides. We're jumping quicker. And I think, which slide are you on right now?
I'm now at the data-driven activation.
Okay, so now we're up to speed.
Okay, now you're up to speed. Okay. I hope that it made sense up to now then, if the slides were not were not aligning with my story.
But sorry, I think about that. We'll send out the presentation afterwards as well, so you won't miss out on anything.
Yeah, and I will take a little bit more time before talking and clicking through, you know. So this slide is actually depicting how the situation was before. So they were using Google Marketing Platform. They had a lot of data signals available, but they were only able to use it partially and really making sure that, you know, they wanted to do the right message on the right time, on the right device, right person, you know, the whole story. They want to do that, but they were only able to do that partially because the Google Marketing Platform is a very good platform to do your marketing in, but it's lacking a little bit of additional possibilities. So that's what we looked in, and we actually put Google Cloud Platform on top of Google Marketing Platform to work together. And by doing that, we created a situation in which we can listen to all those signals and actually see and actually get that right message, right moment, right screen, everything really in place for them. So how did we do that? Let's dive a little bit in. First of all, we created advanced audiences, right? So we got away from the, oh, this is what you have seen the last time, so this is what we're going to show you right now. No, we're going to we put advanced audiences into place to really make sure that we segment people not just on what they have seen last, but how they behaved on the website over time. We also added data from Transavia itself, so their backend data, into the mix to really get that that information shown in the banners, being recommendations, being actual pricing, but also we use that within media bidding to make sure that the bidding is not just done, not every impression has the same bidding algorithm behind it, but that we also use that load factor to ensure that flights that actually need to be sold with a higher priority are getting higher bids. Makes sense, but that's not what happens automatically. So how did we do that? We created the data warehouse. The data warehouse is something that lives in the Google Cloud Platform. When we talk about Google Cloud Platform, a lot of people instantly think about BigQuery because that's the most well-known part of the Google Cloud. And yes, the data warehouse is mainly functioning within BigQuery, but there are a lot of other tools within and processes and services within Google Cloud that help you to create such a data warehouse, to manage such a data warehouse, and to align that with your marketing. Within the data warehouse, we have several layers of data. So first of all, own data, meaning the analytics data from the website, their CRM data, the data of their flights, the availability, everything that's owned by Transavia itself. You have marketing and MarTech data, DVC60, SA360, but also Facebook and also Clang as their email platform. And then finally, there's external data, right? Weather, which is a very well-known example, but there's more. So there's Google Trends, in which you can track how people are searching to specific keywords and what's the index on that on those keywords. How busy is it on certain points of the street? Are there events? You name it. Everything that can be measured can be put into a data warehouse and can be used to actually get better insights, but also to activate better. For this case, we looked into, mainly the Google Marketing Platform, getting the website data and the campaign data in there, and also adding the CRM data, the yield management data, and the price availability and pricing data, all into the data warehouse. But you have to know that if you build up a data warehouse, the data warehouse is something that contains all your data. And when it's done right, it will bring multiple sources of data in one spot, able to talk to each other, being one big data set. But it doesn't do anything. It's a storage. So on top of the data warehouse, we created an audience engine, a yield engine, a recommendation engine, and a marketing automation engine. Those are all, engines that are looking into the data of that data warehouse and take action. In this case, it took action on DV360 Studio to even facilitate better dynamic remarketing, SA360, but also outside of the Google Marketing Platform with AppNexus and Facebook again. Yes, this might become a little bit more complex, right? So like I said before, there's more to it than just BigQuery. There are more tools within Google Cloud Platform that you can use, that you need to use to build up a proper proper data warehouse. Because data is coming in every day, needs to be cleaned, needs to be stitched, needs to be handled, right? But if you have the right knowledge, or if you have the right partner, then this is not your concern. And you can just focus on this. This is what Transavia wanted. They wanted to have different creatives, different ways of to communicate across the customer journey. So not just different types of dynamic content, but also the banner itself differs, right? So if you don't know anything about a specific user and you're really prospecting, ask them, what are you looking for? What can we help you with? But if you know what they're looking for, you can show them, but you also know that they're still browsing, that they didn't decide yet, then you need to inspire them. And you can do that with video ads and that kind of stuff. In the tell phase, you want to explain more about your product, right? And Transavia did the good thing of stepping away from the ticket, because nobody's buying a ticket, but they went to the reasons to fly, right? The experiences. So we created them a tell banner, which is explaining stuff to do in the locations that people looked at. So in this case, it says, enjoy the very nice views in Alicante. But obviously, each destination had multiple to-dos. So it became really, really possible to be really accurate and really informative for each client. And finally, obviously, you also need to sell. So there's also a sell banner in there. But making sure you have all those three types of all those four types of banners in place to communicate on the right way based on the learnings that you have on that user behavior and put them in the right customer journey position, that makes the difference. On top of that, so on top of the different types of communication, we also went made a big step in how to communicate, right? So like I said before, no longer generic information and communication prices. But really, you have looked for a flight from Amsterdam to Barcelona on the 12th of June. There are 16 seats left for the price of 49 euros. This data is taking the price yielding into account. And it was a requirement from Transavia to be 99.9% accurate. And that was achieved by refreshing the data on the actual pricing and the availability every 5 minutes. But you can imagine that once you do this, and the prices are actually right, and people see a price that when they click on this banner, this 49 euros, they go to the website, and it's actually 49 euros, then the disappointment is no longer a factor. So what does it do? Well, we saw a 30% increase in the average order value. We saw a 30% conversion rate increase and a 28% revenue per 1,000 impressions increase. A very important thing to take into account is that we also made a hypothesis on it, that the click rate dropped in the beginning because you are no longer communicating nice prices like 35 euros, but all of a sudden you're communicating prices above 100 euros, right? So the initial click rate might drop. But we also saw that the conversion rate after a click increased significantly and even so much that the decrease in click rate didn't matter at all. And we as a company don't believe in real marketing metrics like click rates and all those kind of stuff, because that's not what you're trying to achieve as a company. What you're trying to achieve as a company is selling your product. So increasing the overall conversions and the overall order values and the overall revenue for Transavia is a real win for us. And in the end, the client was also very happy because they were able to now use a way of communication towards their end client, which is not a one-size-fits-all communication. So really, if you're going to the website, you will not get the same banner every time. On the other hand, they were also able to do an honest and open and transparent way of communication with the prices, which are changing every 5 minutes. So if you're getting a banner now and you're getting a banner in 10 minutes, it could be that the prices are different, but at least they are in line with the website and what you're actually trying to buy. And the good thing on this is that it didn't took them a huge amount of investment as well, because using Google Cloud on top of Google Marketing Platform doesn't need 10,000s of monthly fees just for using the platform. It's a really mean and lean setup in which you can build your own data warehouse, meaning that you are fully in control of what's happening, meaning that you also have access to the data and that you also can make your own logic. You're really, really free in how to approach that data and how to work with it. And if you have a data scientist in your company, or you have a partner that has data scientists that you can work with, then you can also use machine learning on directly tapping into the data warehouse, making sure that you really close that circle. And finally, but definitely just as important, is that this is all living in the same, well, I wanted to say cookie space, but it's not a cookie space, the same data space, right? So that means you don't have cookie matching, you don't have loss due to cookie matching. It's all based in the same data space, and the users of that you are actually having in your data warehouse are actually users that you can analyze, but also directly activate with minimal or no loss at all, unless obviously users change browser, change computer. There is always something, but this solution, this technical solution, had way better results than all other technical solutions tried before. So actually, we are able to do what you want to do for minimal pricing, fitting exactly on everything that Transavia has as technology. And that's basically the case. And I'm very interested if there are some questions. Fabian.
Yes, thank you, Quintine. As I said, please ask any questions via the chat. We're more than happy to answer them either now. We'll be there for a bit, let's say. And any questions we won't be able to answer yet, we will happily answer via email, as I already wrote, and make sure that you've got everything covered you wanted to know. And just to give you a few bits of invitations and information, until the questions start trickling in, if there's any. There is the first question from Chichaona. Thank you for that. How long did it take to do the full implementation?
Ah, the full implementation. Depends on what you're looking at, right? So the technical implementation, I think, it did take several months, to be honest. But the more challenging part, and that was actually quite surprising to me, was not the technical challenges, but basically the assets and the information that they needed for this multiple way of communication, right? So they all of a sudden, one picture of a destination was not enough. They needed pictures of the to-dos in the destinations. They needed text on the to-dos in the destinations. And gathering all that data and also the videos, everything took longer than the technical implementation.
All right. I hope the question was answered sufficiently. The second question from from, you never know, from Wota. How did you connect it to other channels such as email search, meta search, etc.?
Okay, that's actually not that difficult because, for instance, search and meta search, that's actually quite native, right? Because the audiences that we build are generated finally from the Google Cloud towards GA360 for them, and thereon we can push them to DV360, to Optimize 360, to SA360 or Google Ads. So that is all covered. But the data warehouse also has email information. Obviously, it is hashed and salted so that it's very GDPR proof. But it is it does enable us to push the same signals towards their email platform and activating that data within their email platform Clang. And finally, meta searchers. Meta searchers are using the same the same tags that that we're firing in from Campaign Manager. So we are able to really align our message within the tags because that's coming from Campaign Manager, the Google Marketing Platform. And we can even use those audiences to alter the creative shown within a simple tag. So, by doing it that way, we were able, and also including Facebook, for instance, based on the email audiences, to really close that circle. I hope that also answers your question, but I think so.
Yeah, if you need to, if you need follow up on the questions, either type them in now or write us an email. Are there any further questions? Until, let's say we wait. There's another one. How often do you switch out the dynamic templates?
Yeah, this is a very good question actually, because that was the first thing that that Transavia came with, right? So we finished up the initial project. Having it in place, running it for some time, I think running it for like 2 months, because you need to get data. And we were already thinking about the next improvements on the algorithm, on the tech. And then Transavia came like, but can we not switch out the creative templates that we have, or can we not change orders to see and if we can to verify that the things that we're doing are actually right? And that took me, to be honest, a little bit by surprise, but it's very good because then you're trying to make smaller tests with minimal effort, right? To validate what you're doing or to get additional insights. And that was very, very valuable as well, because we saw that our primary assumption of getting people from inspiring to selling doesn't always, it's not always accurate. So we need to dive a little bit deeper into the data to see, okay, some people are showing going on a website for the first time, but their actions are so conclusive, they're really showing that they only want to go to one destination, then inspiring might be skipped because they don't respond to that. They only respond to the actual selling. So by swapping out the different templates, we got additional insights on the users to redefine the audience engine and the algorithms behind that.
Okay, thank you for answering it sufficiently. another question from Paul Combrink. You mentioned that the data warehouse is GDPR compliant. Did the client not have any other security concerns to have all their data in one place?
Obviously, everything that we are doing together with them is crunched, right? So we're not just doing stuff. Everything that we are adding to the data warehouse needs to be okayed by their legal department, by their security officer. So it's not that things are just put into a data warehouse and we'll see from there. There are really strict policies on that. And that also means that not all data can directly flow in there. Sometimes, so for some CRM data, for instance, we cannot directly flow it into the data warehouse. But we'll do, what we can do is make calculations on the CRM data and push the results towards the data warehouse to work from there. That also works, as long as you have a proper pipeline. But rest assured that I think Transavia has their data, their GDPR, their data privacy up to scratch for sure.
As part of France KLM, you should have.
Fair enough.
Okay. Another question from Voter again. What was the increase in conversion from the previous campaigns and how did you measure the incremental effect?
Okay, well, the measuring of the incremental effect was actually done by a baseline comparison, which makes the most sense in such cases. So, and obviously we took into account seasonality and all that kind of stuff. So we tested over broader ranges of dates, dates, to ensure that we are actually comparing the right numbers with each other. But we saw that there was a specific baseline that we are reaching for quite a while with the old setup. And by doing the new setup, we saw significant increases on the same seasonality periods. And that were the differences that I actually mentioned earlier in the presentation. So the things that I mentioned here, the 30% order value increase, the 13% order value increase and 30% conversion rate increase and 28% revenue per 1,000 impressions increase. Those are actually the benefits, the increase that we saw by using this new approach. Also make sure that next to conversion rate increase, we also decreased the cost significantly of media, because we were able to identify which flights are important to sell and which flights are less important to sell. So people looking for tickets that are less important to sell got lower bids or were not bid upon at all, saving media on flights that you don't really want to sell as well. So it was double. Oh. And I think the media savings are not in there. You missed that slide. Well, we're sharing the deck, so you can see it in there.
Absolutely. There is another question coming in from Gianluca. What channel are we talking about for this test? Programmatic through DBM only?
Programmatic through DBM mainly, not only. Also programmatic through AppNexus. Transavia always uses a combination of DMPs, because there's both DMPs have their own strengths. But yes, for this test, it was mainly programmatic. And we're now in the midst of growing this test to other channels. And we're actually, the foundation is set in such a way that we can do that quite easily. So maybe in the near future, we have an additional or a next session on this.
Yeah, and to be fair, we're not limited to the Google technology. So whatever DSPs can be connected, could be connected, right?
Yes. Yes, yeah. as long as we have we need to have user level data of those DSPs to connect it. But as long as we have that and we can activate that via an API or whatever, then it's definitely possible to connect everything.
Great. Are there any other questions? I will take the time until maybe a few more questions come in to give you a few pieces of information. So again, we're very sorry about the small technical hiccups we had today. We didn't calculate with the slide delays. That was something we couldn't take care of as quickly as we wanted to. But as Quintan already said, we are going to send out the presentation to everyone who attended. And we're always open and there for any questions you might have. And this won't be the only webinar we're doing, since we're doing a series with one webinar every second week. In 2 weeks' time, on the 29th of May, we're doing a webinar with our colleague Giuseppe on GA360. So the thing here is that we're talking GA360 versus free Google Analytics, about the differences in sampling, about connections, about everything you can and can't do with either the free or the 360 version. And well, if you're interested in that, you're happily, cordially invited to join us. We'll also send a link through for that as well and do a bit of outreach. So yeah, whoever enjoyed the webinar right now is invited to the next one as well.
Cool.
Great. Thank you very much, Quintine. Thank you very much to everyone who listened intently and asked great questions. And talk to you next time.
Bye-bye.